טוב, לפני שאנחנו עוברים לפאנל המסכם, שהוא יהיה ההיילייט של הכנס הזה, וזה לא פשוט, כי היו פה באמת פאנלים יוצאים מהכלל, אני רוצה להגיד תודה. קודם כל לכם, הקהל הנפלא שבא והיה פה ביומיים האלה, לדוברים הרבים כולם שהציגו זווית ראייה מעניינת והשאירו אותנו בניסיון ובידע ובחוכמה שלהם. אני רוצה להגיד תודה לכל הצמרת המדינית והפוליטית והביטחונית של מדינת ישראל, שמצאה את הבמה הזאת להיות ראויה להציג את זווית הראייה שלהם על הביטחון הלאומי. אני חושב ששמענו פה דעות מכל קצוות הקשת, שלפעמים אני שואל את עצמי אם אנחנו מאותו עם, אבל כל הדעות לגיטימיות במדינה דמוקרטית, והוצגו פה בצורה סדורה וראויה להערכה. אני רוצה להודות לאלופי צה"ל שהיו פה, ראש אגף המודיעין, ראש אגף התכנון ומפקד חיל האוויר. תודה מיוחדת לתומכים של המכון, לחבר הנאמנים הישראלי, לחבר הנאמנים הבינלאומי, לוועד המנהל של המכון בראשות מר פרנק לוי, לפיני כהן שעומד בראש הוועד הישראלי, חבר הנאמנים הישראלי. אבל אני הכי רוצה להגיד תודה לאנשים המדהימים שעשו את הכנס הזה, לצעירים ולצעירות שדאגו לכל פרט, שדאגו שהליין-אפ ירוץ בלי שום תקלה, לקבל את המרצים, לגרום לכך שהכנס הזה יתנהל לא פחות טוב ממסדר כנפיים. ומי שבאמת ניצחה על המקלה, על התזמורת הזאת, חוקרת במכון, דוקטור לירן הטבי, ומי שעמד מאחרי התכנון, שני אנשים שמובילים איתי את המכון, תת-אלוף במילואים אודי דקל, מנהל המכון, והסגנית אורלי הירדני. בסוף תודה למוזיאון, למוזיאון ארץ ישראל, שבאמת נתן לנו אכסניה יוצאת מהכלל, ואפילו תרגל אותנו במצבי חירום ללא חשמל. ותודה רבה גם לחברת ההפקות פאזה, שהייתה חלק בלתי נפרד מהערב הזה. אז אני אבקש עכשיו מהפאנל האחרון, שהוא באמת הפאנל שאולי יארוז את הכל לגישה אחת, אל מול העובדה שאנחנו בפני מציאות אחרת בעולם, כאשר מתחלף השלטון בארצות הברית. והמשמעות של זה לישראל ולארצות הברית הוצגה במשך כל הכנס, אבל מיטב האנשים יעלו וידונו עכשיו בזה בצורה ממוקדת, ואנחנו לא נטריד אתכם בטובות אחרי זה, ושיהיה לכולנו בהצלחה עד שנה הבאה.
So, good evening. That was a good message. Please hang in there. This is actually harder than having a session before lunch, because we're keeping you from going home and having dinner. But we'll try and do our best to entertain you and give you some food for thought before you actually get some food out there. I want to thank Amos, Oli, and the Institute for letting me host this panel, and I want to congratulate you on a wonderful conference and activities for 10 years. I think I've already said on the clip on Sunday that I do highly appreciate the work you do. So we have a great panel with us. I'll just introduce them by name. You don't need their resumes. I think we all know them. We have Ambassador Ambassador Itamar Rabinovich, and we have Walter Russell Mead from the Hudson Institute, and we have General Petraeus, who's been very busy in this conference, and I think this will be your last gig on stage, and Michèle, of course, the former Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, and Ambassador Martin Indyk, Vice President of the Brookings. So, let's be frank and say that some of the brightest minds of policymakers and journalists failed to see what was coming time and time again, and here we are with the new administration in place after the inauguration. Officially, Obama is out, Trump is in, and I think it's been only 5 days, which seem much longer. And when I look at the crowd, I would, you know, allow myself to say that maybe in Washington they would be talking about 2,000 people in the crowd, not just 100. And I would also think that what we've seen so far we could characterize as shaken, not stirred. And we'll see where he takes that from there. And in our neck of the woods, well, we have seen a very optimistic opening with a very warm phone call between Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Trump. We have a special envoy already sworn in and high stakes on him cutting the ultimate deal, as President Trump said. We have a new ambassador and a campaign promise to move the embassy to Jerusalem, not to mention the excitement among the right wing in Israel, who some of them practically believe that the Messiah is now redecorating the Oval Office. And now the title of our panel is Making the Relationship Great Again with a question mark, which underlines an assumption that they weren't as great for the past 8 years. And I am reminded of the lyrics of the Joni Mitchell famous song, Doesn't It Always Seem to Go That You Don't Know What You Have Got Till It's Gone. And we might wake up in a few years thinking she got it right, and we might not. But I think what we want to try and do in this panel in the minutes to come is to try and understand what we can expect from the Trump administration. And I know it's hard to talk about what we can expect because we all know that we can't expect anything and everything should expect everything. And what should be the right policy for Israel to move ahead? We'll start with that. So when Bibi first ran for his campaign in 96, there was a slogan. He was very smart with that campaign slogan, and it was, Bibi Tov LaYehudim. Bibi is good for the Jews. So I want to start by asking you, is Trump good for Israel or bad for Israel? And you can choose to say good and bad, then go into details, or you can go into details. So I want to start with Michèle, please.
I'm the lucky one. Forgive me if I'm losing my voice, but again, hats off to Amos and the whole INSS staff. This has just been an amazing conference, and thank you all for staying for the final panel. I think it's too early to say. There's certainly a lot of hope in some quarters here that the political aspects of the relationship will be smoother, but we should remember that even at times when your prime minister and our president were not getting along as we hoped they would, the foundation of the relationship, the security dimension of the relationship, was very, very strong, perhaps stronger today than it's ever been, in terms of ensuring Israel's qualitative military edge, the extensiveness and the depth of our military-to-military cooperation on everything from cyber to operations to intelligence. And that was culminated in this 10-year memorandum of understanding. So I think it's important that we remember that there are some very strong parts of the relationship coming out of this last 8 years. I think when you look at some of the key people that Trump has appointed on the security side, you have in Secretary Jim Mattis someone who understands the importance of the relationship with Israel, and you can, I'm sure, count on him to advocate for investing further in that relationship. You also have someone who understands the threat posed by Iran. And while he's stated very clearly in his confirmation hearings that he wouldn't recommend ripping up the agreement, he's also talked about doing more to push back on Iran's destabilizing activities in the region. So, you know, I think it's hard to know exactly how all of this will shake out, but you have some strong advocates for the U.S.-Israel relationship inside the Trump administration.
Okay, so that was the relationship is even stronger than the people sitting in the Oval Office. General, what do you think? Is Trump a good news or bad news for Israel?
Well, I think the inclination on entering office is certainly good news. But I would just caution, I mean, we all know that this is a region that is famous for surprises, for bumps in the night, for the emergence of obstacles and problems that you don't even anticipate a year or two in advance at times. And I think the caution would be to recognize, in a sense, if you will, maybe the good fortune that has befallen Israel in this case, but try to work with it. Be understanding that you don't want to put too much strain on even the very good inclinations that I think are present, so that there can continue to be the kind of progress. Again, I think Michèle got it right when she said that, look, at the end of the day, certain substance really matters, and $38 billion is a lot of substance. Think about the amount that it adds to the defense budget of this country, and we should be careful not to think that, you know, that the relationship was perhaps as rocky as sometimes it was reported, despite some of the events, particularly of the last month or so.
And, you know, it's interesting you're referring to the MOU, the $38 billion agreement that was signed. And, you know, there was a lot of talk in Israel about whether the prime minister was right in postponing the dialogue and the negotiations and not trying to cut a deal earlier when the Iran deal was on still not signed and on the table. And I think what I heard from inner circles was that at the end of the day, the prime minister was convinced he would be better off signing the deal with this administration rather than waiting for a new administration. And I don't think Trump was for then the 45th president of Israel. Martin, do you think that is true? Do you think that Trump, in the end of the day, opening champagne bottles in the settlements or in the right in Israel is just too early?
You don't use the word champagne today.
Yes, I didn't say pink champagne. Well, I'm just, you know, our guests, we have issues with cigars and pink champagne now, but.
Well, thank you, Dana. First of all, I'm delighted there are a million people in the audience tonight.
That's an alternative fact.
We should be applauding you.
I could see millions here. Secondly, Itamar and I were present at the creation of INSS, and it's wonderful to see how it's grown, and particularly under the leadership of Amos and Uri and the others. I want to just say kol hakavod to all of you. We're very proud of it. You know, it's very hard to say what Donald Trump will do in this particular case, because I'm not sure that he himself knows. Now, I don't say that as a joke. I say that seriously. He doesn't have any real exposure to Israel or to the issues. I don't think he's come here, as previous presidents had done before they became president. He's clearly heavily dependent on Jared Kushner, his son-in-law, who clearly is probably the most influential person around him, with perhaps the exception of Steve Bannon, and that's important that he's given Kushner the file, because Kushner is so close to him. But as to exactly what is going to happen, we don't know. Now, last week we heard that we should stay tuned for a move of the embassy to Jerusalem. This week we hear that, you know, somehow they're not ready to quite begin the discussions. In other words, there's delay. And the delay means, I would predict, it's not going to happen. Because if you don't do it straight away, the reasons you're delayed are going to be there for all the time of your administration. So I think everybody should be very cautious, and I think Dave Petraeus makes a very good point, is treat this relationship with care. Because first impressions can be lasting impressions. I'm not sure it was such a great idea to announce 2,500 settlement units plus the ones in Jerusalem right now. They clearly got conflicting signals from the administration as to whether this was the right thing to do or not. And I think that's because the administration doesn't have its act together yet. We don't know who the Middle East advisors are going to be yet. So I would exercise, if I were advising the Israeli government, I would say to them, be very cautious in how you treat this potentially very positive development. You need to treat it with care.
Walter?
I'm afraid I'm going to boringly second what people are saying. We're not okay, a very so Israeli panel, I'm afraid. But I would add that it's very important from an Israeli perspective that Israel not let itself get identified with Trump, with President Trump, in the minds of American political people of both parties.
That was exactly my second question to you.
Remember that he did not win the popular vote, that he...
But those were illegal immigrants.
He took millions more people are streaming in as we speak and voting illegally. He took office with the lowest poll ratings of any president in modern history. So we should really not... It would be a tremendous mistake, I think, from an Israeli point of view, to make it look like this is Israel's man, this is our hope. On the other hand, he might be tremendously successful. We just don't know. I think there is one thing that we can predict about what he will do, and it is complicated in its implications for Israel, and that is he is going to push U.S. oil and gas and energy production as far and as fast as it will go. We saw today he issued executive orders for the Keystone Pipeline. And the Dakota Pipeline as well. This is going to be a very destabilizing factor in the Middle East. That is, we can expect the Russians, the Iranians, the Saudis, and others to be a little bit short in the pocketbook. That's good and bad, perhaps, from an Israeli point of view. It probably doesn't point to easy times in the region. So sometimes the kind of declared policies toward Israel of an administration may not tally with the impact of an administration's policies overall in the region. So put not thy faith in princes. Would I think be the best advice I could give you.
Always wisdom from Walter. If I could just comment a little bit further on what Martin was talking about. I don't know of anyone in the administration right now who has the wealth of knowledge, experience, expertise that you, Dennis Ross, a couple of other people, but there's a small number, it's a finite number of people. We know who they all are. And I have not yet seen one of them identified for the administration. Now, the reason I mention that is because I was actually reassured a bit by the caution on the embassy issue after last week we heard, my gosh, this is about to happen. But as you know, this is an issue that, by the way, I'm not sure they can hold this off forever the way previous administrations have just basically forgotten it and nobody was pushing them to do it. The only thing is that
if you ask Israelis off camera and in the room, from Prime Minister to Defense Minister, they don't really want it to happen tomorrow morning.
Well aware of that, but this is a campaign promise. This is an individual who has said he's going to be different, that what he has said he will actually do, unlike all these others. He's the unconventional, unpolitician. He was a disruptor as a candidate, and now he is the disruptor-in-chief in the Oval Office. And so I think it's possible something may be done. Now, but as you know, Martin could tell you, there's a dozen really intricate ways that you could get this. You know, maybe you break ground in the land we already own, but you do consultations first, not just with the Israeli leaders, but of course Jordan, with Egypt, with Saudi Arabia, with all the Gulf states, with the EU, with the other countries, with, again, on and on and on. And maybe you reassure, of course, about the religious sites access, you reassure about the possibility of a capital in East Jerusalem, maybe you break ground there. But my point is that there are second and third and fourth order effects of this, though, that again, only someone like that really understands in a nuanced way, and it will play out for a while. So again, I was reassured to see a degree of caution on this emerge, and that, I think, is positive, although I don't think that it's something that he can just forget. I think, again, that there will be some campaign promises inevitably that are just going to prove impossible to follow through on And so I think he's going to have to do as many of as he can, because some of the others are going to prove too difficult, fiscally or some other reason.
Yeah, it's interesting, and it does help that the ambassador, the incoming ambassador, has an apartment already in Jerusalem, so they could...
So you could open the embassy in his apartment.
Itamar, I want
can
to...
Can I just make one correction on that? I had an apartment in Jerusalem. You know, the U.S. ambassador had an apartment
Do you still
in
have
Jerusalem.
It? So there might be a buyer. I have a buyer for you.
I was the U.S. ambassador, so let me correct that. The U.S. ambassador has had an apartment in Jerusalem since 1995. So the notion that somehow having an apartment in Jerusalem is moving the embassy to Jerusalem is a fiction that I don't think anybody's going to accept.
Itamar, which brings me to Jared Kushner, the young, very successful real estate entrepreneur and investor, and which is all of a sudden being thrown into the Middle East under the title of the broker, and with the expectation, as President Trump said, that if you can't cut a deal, who can? Now, maybe, if you count the numerous envoys before one of them we have sitting on the stage, maybe they might come up with a new perspective. If you had to tell Jared Kushner something, what would you tell him to do differently, maybe to be able to cut the deal?
You know, think outside the box, though I doubt. I mean, we know what the issues are. We know what the problems are. We have a peace process that began in 1973. Everything has already been said and tried, and it's very difficult to find something new or to escape the major issues. But let me say two things here. One about Jared Kushner. If he is the broker or the mediator, we know that mediators and brokers tend to complete the finish line is somewhere around the middle. You cannot be the broker of an Israeli-Palestinian or Israeli-Arab deal by making a deal that is 90% pro-Israel. It won't fly. As a negotiator and a diplomat in the Israeli-American relationship, I always felt that we do not want the United States to become a mediator between Israel and the Arabs. We want to negotiate ourselves and get the United States come in towards the end in order to complete and underwrite the deal. If the United States becomes involved early on, it develops its own vested interest in the success of the deal. It becomes the interest of Jared Kushner. It becomes an interest of the president. The president is very volatile. It becomes a very risky business. Apropos of risky, I think we are entering a very complex, difficult period, because the Trump administration will take shape over the next 6 months. There'll be an encounter with reality. He'll have to settle contradictions in his own statements, and he'll have to settle rivalries within his own team. And in Israel, there's no need to elaborate, we're entering a very difficult time politically, a very complex time politically. So I offer caution for the next few months on both sides.
Caution is a good, Michèle.
If I could just add to that, I think I'm actually worried in this period about a different problem for Israel, and that is this may not be the number one foreign policy priority of this administration. I think one of the top priorities is going to be trying to cut a grand bargain of some sort with Russia. And the thing I worry about is if President Trump, you know, looks into the eyes of Putin and says, you know, I'm going to, you know, we can cut a deal, and he agrees to something on Syria, will he fully factor into that equation Israel's interests? For example, we heard all today the importance of ensuring that Hezbollah does not end up in the Golan Heights. Will that be on President Trump's mind when he's talking to Russia? China, you know, he's taking a very tough stand with China. If the Chinese relationship devolves into a trade war, again, huge impacts for Israel and Israel's economy. So I worry about Israel not being enough of a factor, because in the beginning of the administration, they won't have a fully nuanced,
so what would you advise,
interconnected sense of how these things fit together.
We heard from Minister Lieberman that he doesn't think he should advise anyone unless he's asked. But I want to ask you, if Prime Minister Netanyahu would ask you, how to get those burning issues, those important issues, on the table, what would you tell him?
I would advise him that, you know, you can't pick 15 things, but I would sort of think through what are the most consequential Israeli interests that you want President Trump to have in mind when he's negotiating issues beyond, you know, the immediate bilateral relationship, but negotiating with Russia or dealing with China or what have you.
General, I wanted to ask you, one other burning issue in the region is ISIS, and when we listened to the inauguration speech, there wasn't a lot of concrete policy, but there was this line that we will unite the civilized world against radical Islam terrorism and we will eradicate it completely from the face of the earth. So two questions. A, is it really possible? And B, what could the United States do more in terms of getting this done? I mean, if you look at the foreign policy, I think that one area of consensus regarding President Obama's foreign policy was that he was doing a lot, not saying as much as possible, but a lot on fighting ISIS.
First of all, he may defeat them on the face of the earth or even destroy them, to use military terms, on the earth. But we cannot, and we'll put a stake through the heart of Baghdadi. I mean, again, there's no question that the Islamic State, as John Allen explained, I think, correctly today, is the former envoy for the coalition and did so much great work pulling this all together, and we're now seeing the fruits of his labor and that of his team and a lot of others. But what we are not going to be able to do is put a stake through the heart of the ideological caliphate. That is going to be in the internet. It's in cyberspace. We're gradually learning how to operate better there, but that's going to remain a continuing problem and is one that we're going to have to spend additional effort on, in addition to ensuring that we maintain the progress. And as others on the stage have said earlier today as well, it's not about actually the fight against the Islamic State that is an army. We know how to defeat armies, even if we're using the Iraqis as the front lines with all the assets that we're providing. That's not really the issue here. Now, you're going to have some residual terrorists, you'll have some residual insurgents and so forth, but the battle that matters most is the battle after the battles. It is the battle after Mosul is cleared. Nainoa province, the most complex human terrain in all of Iraq. I spent a year there as a division commander in the beginning in the war. It's going to be very challenging with all the grievances that have been added now because of this time under ISIS and how the liberation is taken out to accommodate all the different groups, the sectarian groups, ethnic groups, political parties, tribal elements, and so forth, and have inclusive governance. The test of governance in that part of the world, in my view, you don't have to get there by democratic elections the way we run them. What it has to be, though, is representative of all of the major different elements and responsive to them within the means available and reasonably honest and, above all, minority rights as well as majority rule. That is a very tall, high bar to get over, and you not only have to do it in Nainoa province, of which Mosul's the capital, you have to do it for Iraq writ large as well.
So do you think that he wrote that line by himself? He rewrote that line after consulting with Mattis and the people that he appointed?
My understanding is that he wrote a lot of that himself, and that sounds like the kind of phrase that I think he would prefer or gravitate to, certainly. But again, I think they're going to be defeated. The question is, again, as was said up here earlier today, are the conditions afterward those that establish fertile fields for the replanting of the seeds of extremism and the rise now of ISIS 3.0, and then you do it, and that's the question. And that's what has to be addressed. And again, I think it was John Allen who talked about that during his panel very correctly. It's inclusive governance is the biggest test of whether or not this is going to succeed or not. In Iraq, you do have a centripetal force that we forget in a country that has lots of centrifugal forces with the ethnic, sectarian, political, tribal differences, and that is the central distribution of oil revenue. And the Sunni Arabs have to have access to that now because they don't even have the Kirkuk oil fields anymore. And frankly, most of the Shia provinces do as well because the oil comes from Basra and Mason and now is going out through the north through the Kurds. But even Iraqi Kurdistan cannot yet afford to be independent, though they'll do an awful lot of talk about a referendum and so forth. But until they can produce a lot more oil and gas and export it illegally through the international markets, they literally just cannot afford to unhinge from the umbilical cord that, however imperfect, still provides them funding from the central government of Iraq.
Walter, I think one of the assets Israel had in the region in the previous years was the fact that a lot of the Sunni pragmatic states, I tend not to call them moderate states, but pragmatic states, were so upset with the Obama administration that they came, they thought, well, we have something in common with Israel. Now, underlining that was the pullback of the U.S. administration from the region. Do you think that this is something that's going to change, or when you listen and think about this Trump administration, are they going to go ahead and regain U.S. primacy in the region, or this is just going to go further on, and then maybe it will change reality for Israel on the ground?
Well, I think it's, you know, it is a possibility, certainly, that if some of the pragmatic Sunni states thought the United States was moving back into its role, they would then feel free to move back toward a more oppositional posture toward Israel, especially if Israel had taken some steps vis-a-vis the Palestinians that increased the political price that they had to pay for a good relationship. So that could be a problem. But I don't think Trump is an order-building president. You know, in America, we have some people in the United States see foreign policy as an arena for opportunity and hope, building a liberal world order, promoting human rights, creating a large international structure of trade and investment. Trump comes from another sort of area of the American political world, and that sees foreign policy as a cost and as a threat. And so there is more of an interest in countering a threat. You can summon up immense resources to fight bad people out there who might attack you or have attacked you, but it's much harder to summon up a lot of will for the sort of careful order building, balancing, fine work of diplomacy. So it may be that the U.S. effort in the Middle East under the Trump administration will be dramatic and kinetic and focused on terror, but there may be less of an interest in trying to recreate an old order, more knock down the bad guys and see what comes up next.
Can I just make a point about this? First of all, there is an ideological strain that comes not so much from Trump himself, but from General Flynn, which is reflected in that sentence about eradicating radical Islamic extremism. And that is going to be a motivating force, an ideological force coming from the White House. That is going to drag Trump in, because if he's going to eradicate it, General Petraeus has just laid out what that's going to take. And that's going to take a major American involvement in this part of the world. And he also wants to make peace in the Middle East and do the ultimate deal. And he doesn't want to make these commitments. He's much more in the Jacksonian mold that Walter talks about. So there is going to be a great deal of, I think, contradiction. Mm-hmm. Plus, there's the Iranian imperative. Yep. And General Mattis, as Michelle has pointed out, wants to take them on in terms of their hegemonic ambitions in the region. So there's a lot of ways in which they're going to get dragged into this, I think, against the president's will. And that's not a great way to approach this region. Unfortunately, if you had a president who was, like Walter suggested, wanting to recreate order in the region, that I think we'd be much more successful than this very kind of push-pull approach that I'm afraid we're going to end up.
I want to point to another contradiction or tension. Secretary Flournoy spoke about the big deal with Russia, with Syria being part of it. Now, Russia is not a single actor or a single protector in Syria. It has Iran. And it's very difficult, on the one hand, to turn Iran into a major enemy, and at the same time to seek a deal in Syria with Russia that will also involve Iran. And what would the deal look like? If the deal ends up with Bashar al-Assad in power over, if not a unified Syria, then the bulk of Syria, the Sunni Arab states are going to be antagonistic to that. So this is one of the major contradictions that this administration will have to settle before it can move on.
I think it's really important to point out that the affinity between the Arabs and Israel is not just the result of their common perception of the Obama administration not loving them as much as previous administrations or withdrawing from the region, whether fair or not. It's really that the Arab states, particularly the Gulf states, have greater concern with threats that have emerged in recent years than they have concern about the Palestinian issue. It used to be, in fact, when John Allen and I were at CENTCOM and would go around the region, you know, issue number one, sometimes two and three, was the Palestinian issue with King Abdullah or some of the others in Saudi Arabia, let's say. Now you go there, and I was just in Abu Dhabi, Manama, and Riyadh. It doesn't even feature in the top six, which would be Iran, ISIS, Syria, Iraq, Yemen, in some cases political Islam. And so what you do have is a common appreciation of threats, because Israel sees almost all of those as threats as well. And then just a little bit more on what more can be done. Here I think you do have to be fair to the Obama administration. As you pointed out, gradually, however reluctantly, grudgingly, whatever, hesitatingly, they have ultimately relaxed rules of engagement, allowed more advisors to go further forward, put in more advisors in Syria. So it streamlined the approval process for strikes and so forth. So there is much less that can be done now than, say, a year ago, although I think there still will be further refinement. And then in the case of Syria, I think there is a good bit more that can be done, although, again, the Obama administration, even in just the final weeks, took steps that would have been unthinkable a year or two ago.
Michèle, knowing the military administration, knowing the defense, the Pentagon, who do you think will be calling the shots when it comes to security and foreign policy?
In the Trump administration writ large, this is what we don't know. You have these potential contradictions, because when you look across Trump's appointments, be it the cabinet members or the folks he's put in the White House, they have very, very different views on a broad range of issues, and he seems to have different views on a broad range of issues. So if you have a traditional National Security Council process, those will be brought to the table and they will be sorted through in a sort of deliberate way. But again, this administration may not follow that sort of typical approach. It may be that policy in some areas gets decided by a much smaller circle of advisors in the White House. It may be that policy gets decided by a 3 a.m. tweet. Or it may be that these things are going on simultaneously and not being fully integrated. So again, I think there's a potential for some rockiness. My own view is that, you know, if the history of first-term American administrations is any guide, there will be some major crisis. It could be North Korea, could be a miscalculation in the South China Sea, could be coming from this region. Some major crisis in the first 6 to 12 months, and probably before the team is fully coalesced, and that will almost certainly be difficult for them to handle. It may result in some shaking out and changes in either of the team's composition or of how the team works.
Martin, going back to the Israel, we have to, I'm going to be a bit quicker now. Going back to the Israeli-Palestinian issue, you know, there, of course, President Obama left a very, what was it, very nice note, wonderful note? What did Trump, how did he relate to the note? Letter.
Best ever.
He said he left him a very nice letter. Of course, he's not going to share with the public what was written there. If you had to leave that very nice note for Ambassador to come, David Friedman, what would you write in that letter?
I think that the most important thing in the relationship is trust. And unfortunately, President Obama, because he had the wrong theory of the case, lost the trust of the Israeli people very early on in the relationship. And that really led to a whole lot of unfortunate developments, made things a lot more difficult. So I would tell him that you know, given the attitude of President Trump and his son-in-law, there's a potential to have a new page and a new relationship of trust. And so don't squander that. And I would also advise him to tell the Israeli Prime Minister not to squander it either, and not to let his cabinet ministers squander it. Because with a relationship of trust, Israel and the United States can do a great deal together. And I do believe that there will actually be opportunities, particularly with the Sunni Arab states, to work together in new ways. But it's really important. The Prime Minister said to the President, there's going to be no daylight between us. Well, that is an obligation on both sides, not just on the America side. And the ambassador to Israel needs to make sure he's talking to the Prime Minister and the other ministers, whom the Prime Minister doesn't exactly control, to make it clear to them that this is a two-way street. And nobody in the United States likes to be surprised when they're in the administration. They don't like Israeli leaks, which are causing constant problems. And you know, the Israeli way of doing business may not be well appreciated in a president who has a short fuse.
And a thin skin.
And very thin skin. So, yeah, exactly. So, you know, I would say he's got a critical role to play, not in terms of giving a green light to more settlement activity, but in terms of preserving that special trust and that special relationship.
Amos, I think you should make sure that this is written down in a letter waiting for Ambassador Friedman to come.
You want some advice to the next Israeli ambassador in Washington, too?
He's not going anywhere.
But the next one, let's say the next one, said, try to restore Israel to being a bipartisan issue, not a single-party issue. Don't get American Jewry involved in trying to clarify or to give a kosher stamp to radical right-wing American elements, and work together with the American ambassador in Israel in making sure that trust is restored and kept.
You know, one senior minister told me this week that it is truly a tragedy because Prime Minister Netanyahu has waited 9 years to be able to work with a Republican president in the Oval Office, and here comes this president, but he's under investigation. And as Amos mentioned, we can already hear the uncertainty of our political system, and they're already talking. So when you talked about ministers not surprising the prime minister, it's going to be harder and tougher for him to contain them because they're not thinking about the relationship.
Anna,
of course, they're thinking about the next election.
If I may. Netanyahu very much wanted a mainstream Republican like Romney. He didn't think of maybe somebody who's not that Republican, and not to be outflanked from the right by the President of the United States.
Which brings me, Walter, we're about to wrap it up, but I want to ask you, your new book, the Ark of Covenant, the United States, Israel, and the Fate of the Jewish People is about to come out. And I want to ask you, when the Israelis, the Israeli public. It's hard to say the Israeli public, but what is generated from the Prime Minister's office and the Israeli public is that Israel is a consensus among the American public opinion. Don't mind what's going on in the White House and the administration. It is a consensus, a bipartisan support. Do you think that under this administration, given the appointments, given the ultra-right people around the president, do you think it will indeed still stay that staunch support for Israel?
I think it's a danger that one of the things I found out in my book is doing the research is how connected non-Jewish Americans and Jewish Americans are in their thoughts about both Israel and the United States. So that sort of liberal American Jews tend to question American assertion, the received national heroic story of the United States, and question the same things about Israel. And on the other hand, the right in both countries tends to celebrate the pioneering spirit and value this kind of national self-assertion. So you have this parallel process. America is becoming more polarized, and it looks at least that President Trump intends, in a sense, to govern through polarization. Arguably, President Obama, to some degree, had the same approach. And as America becomes more polarized, the symbolic role that Israel plays in American politics is not invulnerable to that trend toward a more polarized and bitter public discourse. So I would say it remains a serious concern. Americans will continue to have strong emotions about Israel and about the U.S.-Israel relationship, but those emotions can be negatively charged as well as positively charged. It's a relationship that will need to be tended and cultivated with great care.
Great care, and we're going into very tricky times here in Israel with the political system being very agitated. Yeah, I want to wrap, and I want to ask you. There are two ways to look at this. You can say that this is a new age, Trumpism. We are now entering the age of Trumpism, and it will spill over to the rest of the world. Or you can, at the end of this day, say, well, you know what? We should have expected a backlash. Obama backlash, it maybe went a bit too far. But it's a blip, it will go. It's 4 years or 8 years, and the United States is bigger than that. It's just another political turn in the history of the U.S., of the world. So are you with the new era Trumpism camp, or are you with the, okay, it's just a bump on the road or a different turn in the same story of America and the world?
I would jump into the middle of those options, which is to say, you know, I do think one thing we know about the American body politic and American politics is that it's very resilient, and we do tend to self-correct. If we go too far in one direction, we move back. And I believe that is going to be the case here, too. But at this moment in time, with all of the challenges we face, and after a very tumultuous 8 years in the world, the consequences of what happens in the next 4 years can last far beyond those 4 years. So even if we have a self-correcting system politically, some of the consequences of what happens can be very dire and very long-lasting.
General?
I think we are in a new context, in truth, is the way I would put it. And I think it's not just with respect to the new administration and the inclinations it has as it enters office. I think it's actually a new context globally. And President Trump is one factor in defining this new context, and there could be some more that emerge this year. But this was the year in which it was a Chinese president who spoke of globalism and promoted it and so forth at Davos, of all places. At the same time that the UK Prime Minister was giving a speech that was leading to a hard Brexit and essentially an American firster, if you will, in his own words, was inaugurated as the President of the United States. And you see strains and stresses on the international order that's generally stood the world in pretty good stead since World War II. And you see domestic populism emerging in a number of different countries, real nationalism, in some cases right-wing nationalism, playing a much greater role in a number of countries in Europe as an example. And I don't know that we've really sorted out what all that means. It could be that you do end up in, you stumble into a trade war in some fashion. You stumble into a shooting war. And I think in a lot of ways, it's that global context and how it is evolving and changing that is actually even more important. And then sorting out what the implications are in this particular case for the relationship between the United States and Israel, and indeed Israel's relationships with the others in this region.
Martin, will 2017 go down as a new era, the beginning of a new era?
I have to say, as a Jew, as an American Jew, I am for the first time concerned about the future of the Jewish people in these circumstances. And that may sound very dire. But we have a huge, we as a people have a huge...
Jewish people as a whole or the yes, Jewish people in Israel?
Jewish people as a whole, including those in Israel. We have a huge stake in the Western order that was created in the wake of World War II, which the United States led. And globalization is an outgrowth of that order. And we seem to have a president in the United States today who does not want to play that role of leading the international order, of taking it to the next level. He's made it very clear. It's America first. And you know, the globalization that he attacks, who are the poster children for that globalization? The last campaign advertisement of Trump's campaign was Lloyd Blankfein, George Soros, and Janet Yellen, all of them Jews. Did they pick them because they were Jews? I doubt it. But it makes the point that we as Jews have a huge stake in the European Union, the whole notion of European cosmopolitanism versus the nationalism that we saw that is coming back in Europe, and similarly in the United States, and similarly in the world. And Israel is the beneficiary of that whole era of the US-led international order, which is now in jeopardy. And that worries me a lot.
Anyone can give us a bit of an optimist note to end, Walter? Or are you just going to add to our agony?
I guess I would say this, that the Jewish people and the American people have a sort of a similarity of consciousness. That is, they are each a people very much aware of their own identity and their own history and culture and uniqueness. One could speak of Jewish exceptionalism as one speaks of American exceptionalism. And both are also, both see their destinies in some ways as universal. That is, Americans think that American values are globally valid. And certainly many Jews believe that the core ethical principles of Judaism are not just there for Jews, but are there for all mankind. So Americans, Jewish Americans even more perhaps, and Americans and Israeli Jews are constantly buffeted by the cosmopolitan side of their identity, the universal destiny that they have, and yet then the need, in a sense, to preserve, defend, and even assert that the individual character of the people. That is not something, I think, that gets resolved. It's not that there's one right answer and we find it and we stick to it. It's a tension that's part of the human condition. I think in times like ours, when we have great economic and political and social stress, we see that these tensions come to the fore and become much sharper. Certainly, as I listened today, I heard voices from Israeli politicians speaking to, you know, the universal values of Judaism. We can't, the state of Israel can't lose sight of these. And then I heard other voices saying, if I am not for myself, who is? You know, if the Jewish people don't stick up for Israel, what will happen? And this tension goes all through Israeli society. It goes all through American society. So I don't know if that makes me an optimist or a pessimist, but I think what's happening is that we are being true to our vocation in difficult times.
Itamar, yeah, final word.
Famous last words. I mean, this is neither optimistic or pessimistic. We speak assertively about the American people or the Israeli people or the Jewish people, given demographic trends. 20 years from now, it won't be the same people in America and it won't be the same people here.
Well, I want to thank you so much. I think we did manage to have an interesting, and we gave them food for thought. I want to thank you again, Amos, Orly, all the crew at the INSS. I want to thank you again for a wonderful conference. I think you did a great job, and you've proven again that you are the number one think tank in Israel. So congratulations, Mazal Tov. Thank you again.